I got a couple of things I want to take care of here right quick. Judy, go ahead and put that picture up that I sent you on the here, if you would. I can forgive. I choose to forgive. I will forgive. How many of you know forgiveness is a powerful thing? Right? Well, on Wednesday nights, some of you are missing out on an awesome, awesome teaching. Right, guys? Praise God. Ron, what do you think about this class on Wednesday night? Have you learned anything? Yeah? It's been good, hasn't it? Praise God. I tell you what, we are having an awesome time. Some of the things that I want to read just a little insert from the book here. Because we're finding out that forgiveness is linked to more things than you would think sometimes. And we all know why we're supposed to forgive, but sometimes we don't realize we say, well, it's important to forgive, but I still don't think we have the concept of really how important it is for forgiveness. Things like this, talking about Jesus. We must remember that Jesus was totally man while he was here on the earth. He had to become flesh in order to take upon himself our sins. He had to bear all that we bear. He had to be tempted in every point. He had to be touched with the feelings of our infirmities. He was very much a human with all the emotions and feelings associated with our human state. When he was hanging on that cross, Jesus had every right to resent what was being done to him. He didn't deserve that treatment. He had wronged no man. He had offended no one. He had broken no law. He had stolen no man's goods. He had violated no one's rights. He was innocent. Yet Jesus was wise enough to know that, although he had the right to be resentful and angry, he could not afford to harbor anything in his heart against anyone, even against his enemies. He released the whole matter into his Father's hands. Forgive them, he prayed, and it was as easy as that. What more needed to be said about that matter? That ended it. Jesus forgave. Thank God he did. Amen? Amen. And because of it, he set the example for us, praise God, to walk in forgiveness. Glory to God. And so we'd like to see you on Wednesday night. Praise God. Amen. And this is the book that we're going through. It's called Forgiveness to the Key of the Kingdom. This was written by my first pastor that I sat under after I got born again and came in and started coming into the things of God. And I tell you, when you know the man, you know how important this message was, because forgiveness was not an easy thing at all for him. And the Spirit of God ministered to him about forgiveness. And through this, it changed things in his life and changed things in the church. He pastored there in Wittsfield, Ohio for many years, and which is where I basically cut my teeth on the things of God and on the Word of God. And God really brought healing and different things into his life through forgiveness. So praise God. Anyway, so we do this 45-minute class, 40 to 45 minutes. We're out of there. Praise God. Wednesday starts at 7. Child care is provided. Praise God. And so that's a good thing. Amen. Michael, did you say anything about the pictures? You took care of that. Okay. And by the way, welcome every one of you that's joined us via live stream today. We welcome into our house. We thank God for you joining us and believe for good things. Praise God. Amen. Glory to God. And it's good to have. Now, it's Dave and Sue, right? Okay. I've slept a couple days since then. Those of you remember Dave and Sue. Is it Hockett or Hackett, something like that? Okay. And we're here, what's it been, 3 months ago? Something like that? Christmas time. Girl, Christmas. Wow, that's been more than 3 months ago. Anyway, they have they're back for a few weeks, praise God, and so I encourage you to get to know them, and they're from up around the Coeur d'Alene area, and so one of these days we're going to go up and pay them a visit and see that country up there, praise God. So anyway, it's a blessing to have you guys back with us, praise the Lord, and we just believe good things for you while you're here this time around. Amen. All right, I got something special that we're going to do today. How many remember in the announcements last week that we talked about there was something special going to be announced this Sunday? Remember that? And he said, huh, he said that? I don't remember that. I said, right where you're sitting, I know. But anyway, so the July 24th, everybody say July 24th. We're going to have a fun event here at the church. We're calling this a Pack the House Sunday. And we need your help with this, praise God. And what we want to do is fill this place up and put chairs in, all the chairs we can put in, praise God, and just pack it out. Now, and then after service, we're going to have a cookout. We're going to do some grilling out there, and we need a couple pit masters, praise God, to work that. And so we're and have all kinds of food and stuff, and we're going to have a sign-up sheet for some things that you guys can help us with. But the main thing that we need your help with is bringing people, praise God. Now, I don't know exactly how many is in here today, but how many of you know if each one of us even brought one today, that we would have to set up more chairs in here, right? Imagine what would happen if we each brought two. It might only be standing room, praise God. It's that simple. One and two adds up a lot, right? So it's not like, okay, Billy, you got to bring 30 people. That helps a little bit, right? So now I'm not asking you, we're not asking for invites, and invites is important, but we're asking you to bring people. And we're going to have, and like I said, having a cookout afterwards and just a fun time. I think we're going to, are we getting the, I think we talked about seeing about getting a bouncy house too and have some fun things out here and stuff on the grounds and right after service. And so we're going to have a fun day, praise God. And the message will be geared more evangelistic. We're not going to go into a deep teaching or anything like that. It's going to be, and it'll be in and out, praise God. And we just want to give people an opportunity to, how many of you have ever went to somebody invited you to go to a restaurant and you'd never been to that restaurant before? And maybe after you've been there, it'd become one of your favorites. You know, how do you do? Sometimes you're introduced by things like that. So this is what we want to do. We want to introduce people to our church and our people. I tell you, if you've truly been blessed here, we want to pass that around to people. Amen? So to start out this with, Ashley, would you come up and help me with this, please? Vanna, Miss Vanna White here today. So I have a start out. I would call these our high achievers right here. Praise God. So I've got some. These are commitment cards. What these commitment cards are is we're going to ask you to sign these cards. Everybody loves commitment, right? Guys, remember when you committed to get married? Never had any cold feet, right? Afterwards? Anyway, how many of you know the real things that are worth something take a commitment to do? And you say, boy, this is serious. Well, you know what? Actually, I'll say this. Billy and Judy is a result of basically a Pack the House Sunday that we did at a camp meeting. How many years ago? 2003. I went to Billy and Judy, and I said, guys, I said, listen, I said, I've signed up. I committed to bring some people here. And I said, I would be honored if you guys would be my guests and help me fill that commitment. Would you come? And that was all those years ago. And what a blessing. Have they been a blessing to you in some way, to this body of Christ? And that happened off of one of these weeks. So this is how important it is. And so anyway, so, oh, there you are. She disappeared. How'd you do that? So anyway, so I've got four cards here for our high achievers. These are for people that'll say, okay, you know what? I'm going to take the top one here. I'm going to commit to four people. If that's you, I'd like you to raise your hand. Praise God. And say, I can do four people. Praise God. All right, there's three right there. Or do you want to just do one between? Yeah, okay. So there's two, okay. I need two more, praise God. There's one right there, praise God. And there's one right there. Let's give these guys a hand. Praise God. Now, I want to tell you guys, this takes some doing to go out to do it, you know, to get people. And like I said, not just to invite, but say, you know, I've committed you, and you're coming. I mean, if I have to drag you behind my car, what was it, Americans, Lampoon, yeah, National Lampoon, where'd the dog go? Anyway. Okay, next step down, we have three. See, those are, sorry, you guys, those are in red, see that? Those are in red, praise God. That's because you're special, okay? And what I'd like to do, Pastor Rick, if you'll take this back, and here's another one, and if you'll get them to go ahead and sign that, and then we'll collect them, praise God. Amen. Because we're going to put your name up out here on the board. Hallelujah, praise God. So can I take it back? No, sorry. Okay, so next off, can we trade? Sure, we can trade. Yeah, get somebody, yeah. Okay, so next up we have three, praise God. And I have three, four, I have five. I had four of three, fours, and now I have five of three, praise God. So who says, you know what? I can do three, praise God. I can do that. Three people. Now I will tell you too, children do count, praise God. Amen. And children are important, praise God. So you got three left? Three left of three. Come on. Somebody else that'll do a three. Praise God. And over on this side over here too. Hallelujah. Okay, we'll hold on to those. Praise God. All right. Now I've got some twos. Praise God. I might not go any lower than two. So praise God. Pastor Rick, there you go. All right, here's your twos. This is the time you, how many even know at least two people that's not here today? Praise God. Two. We got some more twos. Come on now. You guys, you can do it. I know you can. Praise God. No trying. No, this is commitment. You don't try a marriage, praise God. No.
I'm going to step up here.
Okay.
This is like a sales tactic, you know, the stall, right? No, but anyway, so what have we been learning about the past 3 weeks?
Faith.
The force of faith.
That's right.
I'm sitting there thinking to myself, boy, I'm not sure if I know anybody I know I could get to come. Is there faith in that statement?
No.
If we took one of these cards and said, I'm going to use that, and I'm going to put my faith with it, and I'm going to bring somebody. Is that faith?
That's
faith. So here's an excellent opportunity for you to practice your faith. Mm-hmm. Give me a four. I got to practice my faith.
I don't have
faith.
Any more four.
All right. Well, give me a three. And then we'll out. Yeah. There you go. Give me two twos. I'm going to set my faith.
Hallelujah. Praise God. Because you know what this stands for? Amen. You know what this stands for? It stands for people's lives.
That's right.
It stands for making an impact. We're not just doing it to say, well, let's fill this place up. We want to reach, we want to see people ministered to. And I believe the love of God, you know, there might be some people out there that's like, you know, I don't feel comfortable about leading them to Christ or something out on the street. Well, guess what? Just get them here, praise God, and let the anointing of God do the work on them. Amen. Yeah, yeah. Okay. I don't believe you have anything to say, do you?
Well yeah. So also, you know, this isn't about just packing the house. How many of you believe in what is being taught here at this church? How many of you have grown from what has been taught here at this church? So it's about sharing that with others and being able to say, listen, you know, maybe you've been to another church and stuff like that, and that's fine. But what we teach here is the Word of God. It's going to help you grow. It's going to help you get further in your life. It's going to help you personally grow, right? But it's also about giving to others also, right? Mm-hmm. And that's what this faith is about. That's what, you know, this faith walk that we have been learning here the past couple of weeks is all about, you know? So put your faith out there for those people, not just to come to this church. And, you know, we want people to come to this church because not just to fill the house, but because we believe in what is being taught
Amen.
Here, right? Yep. And we believe that this is the pure Word of God. It's not being milked down. It's not being watered down. It's not being, you know, just maybe what's going on today, right? This is the Word of God that is being taught in this church. Mm-hmm. And when you have the Word of God that is being taught in this church, like it is here, it helps you grow.
Yep.
It gets you to another level in the things of God and in your personal life. And we want to share that with others. We want others to have that same experience. So that's what this is all about. It's about getting people in here to be able to encourage them that there's something more in their lives that they can have. Amen? All right? Are you guys excited about this? I am. I'm putting my faith out there too. I got a couple that has been on my mind and everything that I want to get them in here. And so I'm putting my faith, the two is just for me. So GJ has to, yeah, she has her own. So I just wanted to encourage you in that and bring a different mindset into this, that it's not just about filling the house.
That's right.
It's about getting people in here that are going to hear the Word of God and have their lives changed. Amen?
Amen. What's really neat is how that when the Word of God is preached, and you get a corporate assembly like this together, and you come under that, the anointing of God does the work. And so it's a matter of just getting people into God's presence and letting the Spirit of God minister to them.
Yeah. Amen. And I know you guys are, tired of sitting and tired of listening, right? So you're like, come on, would you hurry up and get to the message already? This is really important.
It is.
What is the main thing that Jesus said in Mark 16:15? Go ye into all the world and to preach the gospel.
Yep.
Sometimes in our society and world today, it's kind of like, you know, hey, I'm acquaintances with these people and whatever. Here's an excellent chance for you guys to like go invite somebody. Hey, man, I'm committed to bring people this weekend. Would you come and be my guest? This is a great way to, you know, your friends that are saved, that are unsaved, that know Christ or don't know Christ. It doesn't matter. To bring them up, bring them in and say, hey, we're going this weekend. So my challenge is to you is to every single one of you at least take one.
Yep. Amen.
And I'm going to be praying, if you didn't raise your hand today, because next Sunday we're going to be doing this again, and the Holy Spirit's going to be working on your heart all week. So it's just easier to take one now.
Don't say I'm staying away from church next Sunday.
Yeah. And not
we'll
only
stay
that,
after.
Like,
we'll call you
like
up
if
on the
anything,
phone.
If people are like, no, I'll be like, hey, we're doing hamburgers. We're doing free food, you know. You guys come and participate and be involved. This is, all right.
Two, three,
we're going to write one for 10.
Where's my other cards?
Yeah, and you can custom write.
Where's that Sharpie?
Anybody need any customs? Steven's got one back there. This is not about this church so much as it's about reaching our community. Does that make sense
to
everybody?
Thank you, God. Praise God.
It's about just reaching out and others, people that you come in contact with on a, you know, maybe semi-daily basis or whatever, and just say, hey, you know, we got this awesome thing coming. You should come check it out. You know, I guarantee you we're going to give the salvation message during that time as well. And just if there's anybody that needs healing, that needs hope in their lives, this is the time to bring them and be involved in that.
Now, you know, one thing about faith that's really cool about faith is faith challenges us.
So
faith is, we're to be challenged in our faith. What happens? Well, you know, I just don't know. Well, guess what? God, your word is good for it. Praise God. Amen. And how many of you know God will help you because God wants people to hear the Word of God too. God wants people's lives to be touched. And so you're not working alone. You have the Holy Spirit to help you, praise God. And that's what I found out a long time ago. I was the little guy that was just, you know, so timid and so shy and wouldn't talk to anybody. And you say, yeah, right, I'm serious. You ask people that knew me at that time, and that's the way I was. But you know what? I found out that I have a great product, praise God. And it sells itself. His name is Jesus, praise God. Amen. He's the helper, he's the strengthener, he's the lover, he's the encourager. And people, a lot of people, all they've ever seen is religion. They've never seen and experienced the anointing of God, the presence of God, and the love of God. And so that's what we want to do. We want to let people experience that, praise God. So, yes?
Can I give you something?
Sure. You need a microphone?
Okay, I don't want to scare people. But.
Check.
Okay, listen. I'm just going to sing a song that I used to sing. Come on, baby. You're going to sing. Help me. I'm going to volunteer you. And this is a song that I want you to hear the words, but I'm going to give the microphone to Rick because my Spanglish sometimes, you know, be a missionary every day.
Okay,
here we go. It says,
be a missionary every day. Tell the world that Jesus is the way. Lord is soon returning, there is no time to lose, so be a missionary, God's own emissary, be a missionary today.
Yeah, that's good.
And tell the people that God is interested in their lives. Mm-hmm. And that's the only thing, you know, something's, I have asked, have people ask me, how do you make friends? How can you just go and tell people about Jesus? How can you do that? I am embarrassed to bother people. And you know what? I have found out, I just signed up to be a rep for Juice Plus. And I told my rep, I said, I will never do that. I will never sell anything. The only thing I sell is Jesus, I will say. But then I found out that I really, really like the product. So I've been sharing. I'm not embarrassed about it because I know it's a great product. And I was just thinking, man, that's just a product.
Yeah.
Man, something that you have to pay money with it. And I'm not embarrassed about it. But when I think in Jesus, that's free.
Mm-hmm.
And it brings an answer for any problem. Amen. And the only thing they have to invest is their own time and life. So just go anywhere. You have somebody, a coworker, a family member and stuff. Maybe they're struggling. Everyone around is struggling in life. So you can just tell them, you know what? I have something special. Come with me this Sunday. And let's
God.
Spread the word.
Amen. Thank you, Gijay. All right. Real quickly. Do we have any more? We got two here yet. Praise God. And who'll take some ones, praise God? Who says, you know what, I can handle ones. Where's my Sharpies at? Oh, did you steal them? Did you steal my Sharpies? Reposition them, okay. Praise God, okay. Here's one. Who else says, I can handle one. I can do one, praise God. All right. Thank you, Brother Dave. Praise God. I want to give one more out. One more. Who will take one more? Praise God. And we'll call it good. Praise God. One more. Uno. Praise the Lord. Then I'll start preaching. Praise God. Hallelujah. You gals in the sound booth, did you get a card, one of you? Praise God. Come on, stretch your faith. Come on, you can do it. I'm putting you on the spot. This is good. We need to be put on the spot sometimes. Praise the Lord. One. Hallelujah. Praise God. Thank you, guys. Now, this is what I want to do. I want to pray with each one, and we're going to believe God that every one of these people that you'll be surprised how easily it is, praise God, as you bring people and see them ministered to. I tell you what, to me, the joy of seeing people ministered to. And I thank God for Billy and Judy. And Billy and Judy, you've had sowed into your life. It's time to sow into others. I mean, I know you do, but continue to do that, you know. And that's the thing about making new life, is there's people out there that are hurting. There's people out there that need help. And all they've heard is religion, but they've never, it's just a form of God, but they haven't seen the power of it. And we just need to let them know that God is there to help them and to strengthen them and love them, praise God, and we can have a part in that. So let's pray. Father, right now, I thank you, Father, for every person that took one of these cards and said, Lord, I'm committing. I'm stepping out here. I'm asking for your help. And so right now, Father, in the name of Jesus, I thank you for your help for each person. And that, Father, as the 24th of July rolls around, that, Father, we will pack this house for your glory. And, Father, we'll see people ministered to by your love, by your compassion, and by your goodness. So, Holy Spirit, we ask you, Father, as they've made the step of faith to do this, and each one, and myself included, that, Father God, that we expect your help. Holy Spirit, begin to lead us to the right ones to go to, direct us and give us favor with them. And, Father, let them see that this isn't just about something, but, Father, it's about them. And, Father, we just give you glory for it, and we just expect good things out of this in the name of Jesus. Praise God. And everyone said? Amen. Amen. Praise the Lord. All right. 51 committed. Praise God. Well, I didn't get to do mine here yet. Praise God. Let me sign mine here. Praise the Lord. God is good. Amen? Amen. All the time. Amen. So, you know, we love to come and just hear, you know, good things. Praise God. But how many of you know that the Word of God is the Bible says, faith without works is dead. It doesn't accomplish anything. It doesn't make anything happen. And the thing about it is, if we're really people of faith, that's how we live. That's how we walk. And we should be keeping our faith busy at all times, praise God. Amen? Well, there's always things. There's souls to be born into the kingdom of heaven. Lives that needs to be changed. And this is what we want to do. We want to impact lives. Let me ask you something. If you were that person that didn't know Christ, would you, and now knowing what you now, looking back on that, would you like somebody just leave you alone and just end up dying in your sins and going to hell, living eternity in hell? That's a terrible thing. Not a one of us in here would ever want to be in that position. But we're thankful. I'm thankful for people that have shared the gospel with me, that spoke the word of God to me in my life, and how it has changed my life. And I'm thankful that God used people to do that. And so this is what it's about, is using our faith to affect other people, praise God. And how many of you know faith is a force? It's powerful, praise God. It's able to move mountains. It's able to bring mountains up and cast them into the sea, the scripture says. Amen. It's able to bring healing to people's lives. It's able to bring supernatural things into our lives. It's able to cause jobs to manifest. It's able to faith is able to bring health and healing to our bodies, praise God. It's so much. It's on and on and on that the Word of God, this is real. This is where we're at as a Christian. This isn't just something, oh, these are just great words. But I'm telling you what, folks, you and I as Christians, we are commanded through the Word of God to live by faith, praise God. And it's an awesome life, I'm telling you. Because you and I get to walk into things and do things that a lot of people never will, because if they can't buy it, or they don't have somebody to pull strings or to work it, it doesn't happen. But by faith in God, praise God, I'm telling you, things begin to happen and take place, and it's exciting. Folks, I would not be standing where I'm at here today if it wasn't the walk of faith, praise God, in my life. Because I'm telling you, time after time, there's been things that look totally impossible, should never have happened. But I'm telling you, God honors His Word. Amen. He honors His Word every time, praise God. Amen. Amen. So today, a little bit, would you bring these lights up, Bree? It's kind of dark up here. So today, a little bit, I want to talk about how does faith come? How is it developed and how is it maintained? Praise God. So turn in your Bibles, if you would, to Romans, the 10th chapter, and we're going to start right there. Hallelujah. I tell you what, of anything scripturally concerning a truth, faith is probably, faith and love, they work hand in hand. They're right there, faith, but faith doesn't work outside of love. Amen. And love doesn't work outside of faith. They need each other, praise God. They're twins together. Romans chapter 10, verse 17. Romans chapter 10, verse 17. Read here out of the King James. So then faith cometh. Everybody say cometh. Cometh. Oh, that you could preach that right there. Faith cometh. How does faith cometh? By hearing, and hearing by the word of God. Short scripture, short and to the point, but very powerful, praise God. So how does faith come? How does it faith comes by hearing. Everybody say hearing.
Hearing.
Well, if faith comes by hearing, how many of you know that usually when we say hearing, we think about, what do we think of?
Ears.
Our ears, right? But how many of you know that faith comes by hearing, that word hearing includes more than just our ears? Faith comes by hearing with our ears. How else does faith come? By our eyes, what we see. That's the way that we hear, even though it's not with our ears. It's still a way, the word hear is to comprehend, to grasp, to get a hold of. How does that happen? And when we hear it, it comes in, we listen to it, and we think upon it. It goes, passes through our mind. As we continue to think on it long enough, it'll drop into our spirit, right? We see it. What did we just read right here? Faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. Are we hearing this? We're seeing it, but are we hearing it? Yes, we are. So we're not just talking necessarily about natural seeing and hearing, but we're really talking about perceiving it, grasping it, getting a hold of it in our spirit. So the ears that we hear with, by our spirit, is our natural ears. We take it in. Our eyes. And how many of you can think maybe of another way that we hear? Somebody say it.
Mouth.
Mouth. Speaking. Right? You say, how can a mouth be in the ear? Because when you speak the word of God out your mouth, you're activating something. And it will get into your spirit because you do hear it, praise God. And that's why it's so powerful to speak the word of God. It's so powerful to speak God's word. You don't go through life, an effective Christian, a Christian that's walking in his authority and getting things done in life, does not walk through life keeping his mouth shut. Hallelujah. I like what Mark Hankins, he's got a message he preaches, a statement he made. Never run at your giant with your mouth closed. Never run at your giant with your mouth closed. What did David, how did he approach Goliath? He says, you uncircumcised Philistine. In other words, one without a covenant with God, today you're going down. Uh-huh. See, what did he do? He went to that giant. He was walking by faith, and his words went before him, and his words was painting a picture and was doing things and was working for him, but it was also stirring his faith. He was stirring his own faith by the words that he said. What was he doing? He was committing himself, praise God. He was committing himself. He was committing God. He was saying, this is the course I'm going on, praise God, and my God will deliver you into my hands this day. I've always wondered what would have happened with that fight had he not spoke those words. Did you ever think about that? He may not have won that battle. Matter of fact, there's a good chance he didn't. But his words were powerful. The Bible says God's word is like a two-edged sword going forth, piercing asunder. It's able to cut. It's able to do something. The force of faith is powerful, praise God, coming out of our mouths. But faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. How many of you know faith doesn't come by having heard? Scripture doesn't say that. It says faith comes by hearing. It doesn't say faith cometh by having heard. In other words, your battles today must come from fresh faith today to defeat your enemy. Tomorrow's battle must be won by tomorrow's faith. You can't store faith up for a rainy day. Say, well, you know, I read my Bible yesterday, so I'm a spiritual giant today. Guess what? No, it comes from staying continually in the Word of God. Most of you remember the story. I've always usually used Nancy Winslow on this because at the time Nancy and Dick were living in Riverton. And so I used this story. I said, what would happen if Nancy Winslow, you know, she before she left Riverton to head over here when they was living over there, that she got everything in place, all of her makeup and her lipstick on just right and everything. And she made the drive from Riverton to Lander, but when she walks in, I say, Nancy, bless your heart, you got lipstick all over your face. Now, what would she do? She would go find her a mirror, right? Do you think that she could reply without a shadow of a doubt, there is not any lipstick on my face? She would only do that because she knows me. But if not, if somebody told her that, how many of you know that there would be doubts gendered in her mind concerning her lipstick that she needs to go check it? That something may happen, because I'll guarantee you, Nancy is one that she don't want anything out of place. It's got to be right. Right, Dick? So, amen. So, where would the first place Nancy go? She goes to look into the mirror, doesn't she? Well, didn't she look in the mirror when she left home? Well, now this is a relationship, a correlation between us looking into the mirror of the Word, right? So when we look into the mirror, the Bible says we see what we look like by looking into the mirror. And so she looks into the mirror before she leaves Riverton, but she's got a 30-40 minute commute over here, and by the time she gets here, without looking in the mirror any other time, when something is said, there is some doubts generated there that, yeah, maybe it's just not perfect. I better go check, right? Mm-hmm. Now, what would happen, though, if she's out in the car, or let's just say she just made a trip inside and she went to the bathroom and she checked everything and everything was just perfect. Come down the hall and into the church, and I said, Nancy, you got lipstick all over your face. What do you think her response would be? I don't think so. Do you see that she could be a whole lot more confident about that than she did before the other scenario? What's the difference?
Time.
The only difference is the time driving from Riverton to here as opposed to the shorter time here, right? Well, duh. It's the same way with the Word of God. The same way that faith comes on a continual basis by hearing, by not having heard, but by hearing. But as you, every day, folks, that's why you and I, we must receive from the Word of God. We must look into the Word of God and have our faith grow and use our faith for that day. How many of you know a great example in Scripture that we see concerning that was whenever God delivered the Israelites out of Egypt? What did God do? He provided a manna for that day. He said, you don't worry about tomorrow. I'll bring tomorrow's manna to you fresh. Amen. And so, see, that's the way the Word of God is. Every day we look into it, we need fresh faith. Are you with me? We need every day a fresh insight into the Word of God. We must look into it daily. We can't look into it one day and then go 2 or 3 days and expect to go slew our giants. We can't expect to be walking in divine health. We can't expect to see all of our needs met if we're never continually replenishing our faith on a daily basis to be fresh, 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 fresh. So remember this, Fresh word produces fresh faith. Amen. I said, remember this. Fresh word produces fresh faith. Amen. Hallelujah. And most of you was here before, and how many of you know? Some of you maybe didn't know this, but you know, I did write a book. It's called Faith Cometh By. Hallelujah. Pastor Rick, would you come up here, please? Microphone. Would you mind reading that book to us, please?
Yes. Faith Cometh By.
Let me hold this here. You'll need both hands.
There you go. Hearing and 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 hearing.
Praise God.
That was deep.
That was deep, wasn't it?
Yeah, that was good. Took you a long time for that, didn't it?
It did. Praise God. So, you get the point? So what happens? It's not just having heard, but it's a continual hearing, isn't it? Hearing and hearing and hearing and hearing and hearing and hearing and hearing. That word hearing, in its original context, is a continuation word. It never stops. It's a continual thing. If it stops, faith begins to stop. Interesting. So that means, so how does faith come? Faith comes by hearing and hearing and hearing and hearing and hearing. So in other words, every day we need to be listening to the Word of God or things to produce faith. How many of you know every day we're listening, we're seeing, we're speaking, we're hearing things? But what things are we? Whatever we're hearing, it's producing faith, and everything produces after its own kind. So whatever it is we're looking at, whatever it is we're listening to, whatever it is we're speaking, guess what? That's paramount in our life. That is what is in our life. What we're saying, what we're looking at, what we're hearing with our ears, what we're doing, that is producing a confidence in something. What is that confidence? You know, we might as well just make sure that we're getting confidence, working towards confidence in the right thing instead of the wrong things. If we keep saying, I'm sick, guess what? Faith is released, and that's exactly what we'll be. Oh, really? Yeah. I'm broke. I can't afford it. Guess what? Day after day after day, you'll be broke and you can't afford it. Whatever it is, you can't afford. Are you with me? So we're saying, we have what we say, but faith is coming by hearing, by speaking the words, whatever we're saying, by listening to them, by looking at with our eyes. What are we watching on TV? That's why when I'm watching TV, especially when it gets sometime around the fall or whatever, you know, they start all of a sudden putting all these ads on here. You know, flu season's on us. And you better talk back to that thing. I said right there, when I hear that, I said, in the name of Jesus, not in this household. We don't have flu season in this household. We live in divine health in Jesus' name. I don't want faith in being sick. I have faith in the Word of God. I know what God's words promise, praise God. Don't you let the world, don't you let things and people tell you and dictate to you your faith, where your faith stands. You declare it. You look at it. You read the right things. You listen to the right things. You can't be listening and looking at all this negative stuff and expecting to sleep in the peace of God. You can't expect God to work with you looking at negative stuff and wrong stuff all the time. Hallelujah. It's true. So faith comes how? By hearing, and hearing by the Word of God. Praise God. Okay. Faith grows out of the Word, not by praying for it. You don't pray for faith. Okay, Jordan, why don't you just agree with me, brother, that I'll have more faith? Did you know that's 100% unscriptural? There's nothing in the Word of God. The only thing that even comes close to that is pray that our faith fail not. Doesn't say anything about. In other words, praying that that person, you and I pray for one another, we stand stalwart in faith, praise God. But you know, you and I could agree and pray all day long we want to for faith and not an ounce of faith will come. Because that's not how faith comes. It's not how faith comes. But yet in the church world today, many Christians feel like if you just pray that I'll have more faith. There's nothing in Scripture that substantiates that. No, faith comes by hearing and 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 hearing over and over and over and over again. Hearing and hearing and hearing. We're surrounded by things in this world that is speaking to us. See, you remember the account there in Mark 11th chapter where Jesus spoke to the fig tree? Did you ever think about that? I mean, very plainly, if you read that, you see where it says, in passing by the fig tree, Jesus answered the tree. Let's go over and look at that. Go to Mark, the 11th chapter. Hallelujah. Mark chapter 11. Verse 12, and on the morrow when they were come from Bethany, he was hungry. Speaking of Jesus, and he, Jesus, seeing a fig tree afar off, having leaves, he came, if haply he might find anything thereon. And when he came to it, he found nothing but leaves, for the time of figs was not yet. And Jesus did what? I don't know. Answered and said unto it, right? Jesus answered and said unto it. Unto what it?
The
fig tree, right? I mean, how do you answer something if it's not talking to you? It was talking to him. It was saying, you're not getting no figs from me. You don't tell Jesus you're not going to bear fruit. Because it was time. Basically, the wording on this is not very good, but the time of figs, there should have been figs on that tree because there was leaves on it. The leaves had budded out. There should have been figs on that tree. There was no figs. The fig tree was saying, you're not getting no fruit from me. And Jesus answered, you know what? The world around you, there's things talking to you. Telling you can't do something. Telling you can't have something. Telling you're not good enough for it. You're going to have to do some answering if you're going to walk by faith, praise God. If you're going to get victory over that, you're going to have to answer and say, ho, 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 the greater one dwells within me, praise God. I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. Amen? So if it was good enough for Jesus, it's good enough for me. How about for you? So you got to answer things in your life. Why? How do you do it? It gives faith something to work on. Without the word spoken, without it going out, words being going out, faith has nothing to live off of. That's what where faith lives is in faith-filled words. Hallelujah. Faith-filled words is what God said. God says, my word, how powerful is it? It's powerful as a two-edged sword, but it'll not return unto me void, he said. Void of power. Why? Because it's filled with faith to accomplish things. So you and I, when we speak over our families, when we speak over one another, when we speak over our jobs, we're to speak the word of God. How can we go about doing that? I have years. When I would go to work, I'd say, Lord, you've blessed my hand. You said you'd cause all that my hands touch to prosper. Well, guess what? Faith can, those are words that carries faith. Those are words that'll work for you, praise God. So when you work with all confidence, you're doing it knowing that God is blessing the work of your hands. And I have seen it all through the years, how God has blessed the work of my hands because I honor him on that. I'm not trying to put a pin on my chest. I'm just saying this is how God works. He works through our words. And I also have the promise that the ground that my feet tread upon is blessed of the Lord. Praise God. Because God's blessing lives in me, and where I go, his blessing goes. And so I expect that. I like it. When I go places, and I'm very aware that God's going with me. I'm aware, very aware of his blessings are going with me, praise God. And I'm very aware of, Lord, what do you want to do here, praise God? You took me here to do something. You took me here so that you could come here, praise God. And so with confidence, with all faith, you can stand and you can go in that place, and you can see God manifest his goodness, praise God. Mm-hmm. So that's what God wants to do. That's how he operates. So faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. Faith grows out of the word, not by praying for it. Prayer does not cause faith to work. Faith causes prayer to work. I need to say that again. Prayer does not cause faith to work. Faith causes prayer to work. Hallelujah. One more time. Prayer does not cause faith to work. Faith causes prayer to work. Romans chapter 12. Let's go back over there. Romans chapter 12. And let's look at verse 3. Jesus says, let's back up to 1. Paul saying, I beseech you therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service. This is a whole different message, but you need to make sure what you're doing with your bodies, that you're glorifying God in and with your bodies. Your body's not your own. Say, my body is not my own. It's bought with the precious blood of Jesus. So be very careful what you do with your body. God gave it to you to be a blessing to you here on the earth, to glorify God, and we are to glorify God in our bodies. That's a whole different message. In verse 2, and be not conformed or fashioned to this world, but be ye transformed by the renewing, everybody say renewing, of your mind, that ye may prove or discern what is that good, acceptable, and perfect will of God. For I say, verse 3, through the grace given unto me, Paul was saying this, to every man that is among you, not to think of himself more highly than he ought to think, but to think soberly according as God has dealt to every man the, everybody say the measure or degree of faith. So what he's talking about is a degree or a measure or a limited portion of faith. You and I is not been dealt out full faith, praise God. We have been given out a measure of faith. You and I have been given something. I like to say it this way. You and I have been given a seed of faith. All right? Now that seed requires something done with it. It requires that it be planted. It requires that it be watered. It requires that it be taken care of, attention given to, so that it can grow and produce, praise God. Amen. So the measure of faith that's given to us is this. When a person is born again, accept Christ as their Lord and Savior, there's a measure of faith that comes into their heart to get you and I started. That's what we started with, praise God. All of us that are born again, that's where we started. There was a measure of faith given to us to say, you know what, I recognize this is right, this is good. And there was a measure of faith, a confidence inside, out of anything that came with the package of getting born again, that said, you know, I can do this Christian walk. Now, if you don't follow through with that and add other faith to it, that's where people get in trouble. They fall away. Because what happens? faith from the world begins to come in and says, and the negative things begin to come in, and it brings doubt in that faith that was sowed into that person's heart to say, I can live this life, I can walk this life. I like to have it like, think about it like this. God, He gave us the package of everything He is in us, praise God, and even put an assurance on the inside of us when we're born again that we can live for Him. As hard as it might seem around, it just, you know, a few minutes before that had no concept, and all of a sudden now we have the concept, I can do this. This is good, I can do this. But how many of you know it's just like Nancy Winslow having to look into the mirror on a continual basis? You and I then have to go back and revisit that and find ourselves in Scripture just like Jesus did, and so that faith will grow within us, and so that we can go to the next level and to the next level and to the next level, line upon line, precept upon precept. Faith is built and established one block upon another. So faith does not, just by having heard or just in the very start, I mean, that's a great place to start, but how many of you know that God wants us to go on from there, praise God? And the Holy Spirit is there to help us. But folks, there's nothing takes away from our commitment to the Word of God, to spend time in the Word of God and spend time listening to the Word, reading it, praise God, speaking it out of our mouth, spending time in His Word, spending time in His presence, so that our faith will grow from glory to glory, so that tomorrow we'll be actually in a stronger place than we are today, and the day after that, a stronger place than we are tomorrow. So it comes by growing, doesn't it? It comes, the necessity, it's just like, what happens if you and I, all of a sudden, we say, okay, you know what? This morning when I had breakfast or whatever, that's my last meal I'm ever going to eat. Last meal, no more food for me. Look, I got plenty. Last me. I don't need any more food. I'm in good shape. How many of you said, yeah, in a couple, 2 or 3 weeks or so, we'll come see you maybe in the hospital? Uh-huh. Or maybe in about a month, you say, well, you know, or so, you know, we'll have sticky in the ground. But do we put that same thought into our spiritual life? Did you know that our spiritual food is just as is essential to us as our natural food is? We are a number one, a spirit, right? Our spirit man must be fed. And many Christians are walking around and their spirit is weak, weak, weak. They're still born again, but they're not accomplishing things in life. They're not getting things done. Things is not happening in their life because they have not fed and nourished their spirit man. But taking good care of the flesh. Hallelujah. Praise God. And I got to hurry. I'm out of time. Romans chapter 1. It's back up to Romans chapter 1. We'll finish this up here. Romans chapter 1. And let's look at verse 16. Paul again says, for I'm not ashamed of the gospel of Christ. What is the gospel of Christ? Good news of Christ. What is the good news of Christ? Are you holding it in your lap? Is this the good news? The Word of God? Isn't the Word of God the gospel? Isn't it? It's what we share with people. We give to people to bring hope into their lives. Amen. For I'm not, so we could say, I'm not ashamed of the Word of God, the Word of Christ, gospel of Christ. For it is the power of God unto salvation. This word is so powerful. It's the God. It is the power of God unto salvation to everyone that believeth, to the Jew first and also to the Greek. For therein, wherein is it? The gospel of Christ in the Word of God is revealed. Is the righteousness of God revealed from faith to faith, as it is written, the just shall live by faith. Praise God. This is where we're at, folks. This is what causes us to walk by faith. This is what causes the confidence to come in our life. When everything is talking to you and telling you you can't do something, you can't afford something, you're not going to make it, you're going to die early, all these negative things. When you get into the Word of God rises up in your heart and says, bless God, I know what that says, but I know what the Word of God says. I can walk this walk. I can live and not die and proclaim the works of the Lord. I can live in goodness, praise God. I can live in victory. I can live in righteousness, praise God. I can live in holiness. I can do this because the Word of God comes out of that. It comes by faith, by having heard the Word of God. Praise God. Amen. Stand to our feet, please. Faith should never be allowed to stand still. Faith should never be allowed to just to take a back seat to anything. Faith should never be allowed just to lay dormant and not accomplish anything, because your faith will do things and take you places that you would never be able to do or ever be able to go in the natural. So don't ever look at something and say, well, that's too big for me. I can't do that. Who am I to do that? It's not who we are, it's who He is. The greater one within us. I said the greater one within us. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Jordan, I just heard this. The word of the Lord says this to you. The seed's been sown in your heart. Be careful to not trample it under feet. Know this, what God started is what will flourish, not what you start. I don't know where you're at in life and things, but I do know this. I know that the Lord says, having begun a good work in you, I will complete it and finish it. He didn't say, having begun a good work in us, what we come up with, He'll complete and finish. So I want to admonish you this very thing. Just make sure anything that you do is God-inspired, God-breathed, not your ideas. That goes for all of us. But for some reason, the Lord wanted you to hear that this morning. So maybe you're in the middle of something, or about to start something, or giving thought to something. I don't know, but that's what the Lord does. Because your heart is right. And also, don't be concerned about people judging you this or that. Let that go. That's something to trip you up. Care less about what people think or whether, oh, are they judging me or not. It doesn't matter. They judge Jesus all the time. He never said anything about people not judging him. He never heard Jesus say, I wish people wouldn't judge me. Never said that. He could care less about it. What matters is you walk pleasing unto the Lord. Keep your heart right to the Lord. Let Him take care of it. Praise God. Oh, He's good at what He does. Man, it's good to have you guys here. Oh, awesome. Praise God. Love you, buddy. God's good. So, today, take away from this. Hopefully, that all of us need to spend more time in the Word of God. That faith comes by hearing. Faith is established by hearing more. Amen. Faith is built. Faith is produced in our life by continually adding to faith upon faith upon faith. What gets you faith coming your way keeps faith growing. The same thing. It's not one thing how faith comes and then you pray about it and your faith gets strong. No, it doesn't work that way. No. By hearing with our eyes, with our ears, speaking the words out of our mouth, faith comes. Like this morning, in this room today, I know for a fact that faith has come to some of you by having heard the Word of God. This is what we're going for today. That faith coming to you has caused, or that Word coming to you has caused faith to rise in your heart and spark some things on the inside of you. Now that's a good start, but guess what? You can't live tomorrow off of that. Tomorrow, then you have to get into Scripture, some of the Scriptures maybe we talked about today, and go over them again, praise God, and let then that be begin to be established, praise God. And the day after that, the same thing. So I tell you what, be good friends with your Bible. Be good friends with the Word of God, because you need the Word of God. It's what produces within you and I, praise God. Amen? It's a force, praise God, that is built. And God wants you and I to be stronger tomorrow than we were today. And stronger yet the day after tomorrow, praise God. Amen? Strong faith. And when you're walking in strong faith, you don't have to tell somebody, hey, look at my faith. No, you don't even realize you're there. It's just a confidence that comes on the inside that says, bless God, I can really do all things through Christ who strengthens me. Amen? So, Father, I pray over this congregation today. I thank you, Father God, for what's been started will be completed in lives, Father God. And I thank you, Father, for what you started in us that you're completing. And so as we go our way this week, we expect the force of faith to grow stronger and stronger within us as more we commit to the Word of God. And we give you praise in the name of Jesus. And everybody said, amen. Praise God. Be blessed. Go in God. Amen. Lord.